I'd like to kickstart this with asking my fellow panelists. It's an interesting topic, and I think Mayank did touch upon that with a good example of Hema stores and of Alibaba Hema stores, and how while it is the holy grail in today's context to try and link an offline or an online to an offline channel, there are tremendous challenges in that. What we have on our topic, and I'm expanding that for our audience's benefit and not just talking of a multi-channel approach, because to me, multi-channel could have a siloed approach of each channel being addressed by somebody for that channel. I'd rather put a horizontal layer to that and call it an omni-channel, if that's okay with my fellow panelists, which basically brings in all together seamlessly from a service experience perspective. So what I did want, and the way we'll do this is go around right now and ask my fellow panelists to give their views. Fundamentally, I think I will take the last 2 years, say March of 2020 onwards. While people have called it a constraint, I will call it an opportunity for all of us. All on this platform are, well, 95%. Dhanraj, I'm taking 5% as for automobile offline, but yes, Let's assume all of us are fundamentally online. In Myntra, Swiggy, Vedantu, we are online. So in this context, I think CX online has benefited a lot more in the last 2 years. So let's call it as an opportunity of the businesses in the last 12 to 18 months. In your organization, whether it's okay to go multi or omni, what is it that y'all have done to enhance the digital roadmap to take care of the immediate business need due to the pandemic? But having said that, it also have been part of your regular business plan. What have you all done to enhance or improve the quality of experience? And I have a couple of examples, but I'll come back to that later, where I found that being a challenge, because suddenly you were faced with a lot of customers trying to get in touch with customer support or customer service. And because of the pandemic and remote location, people working from home, that network was not as well established, because while it's easy for a Google to say, we'll give everybody a laptop and a dongle and you can be connected, I do see a lot of headwind organizations faced in finding a distributed customer service network being built. So I'd just like your views on it. Maybe if you want, we can start with you, Bindiya, if you can just give us, you're also at the forefront of cutting edge technology, that how is the last 12 to 18 months driven your business strategy in terms of digitization or an omni-channel, multi-channel presence?
Hey, hi everyone, hi Ajay. Since we are, like you said, like, I mean, we are an e-commerce company, but still, despite that, there are a lot of consumer trends that we saw with this whole pandemic coming in, right? First of all, right, I mean, overall from consumer perspective, we got close to about 400 to 450 million consumers on our platform every month, right? And that's huge traffic, right? What was very important for us to ensure at that point is to ensure that consumer feels engaged. So there was a lot of content, that also relevant content, that need to be pushed to the consumer in terms of gamification, in terms of the kind of games that we were trying to push out to the consumer, in terms of personalization, for instance, right? Because not everybody wants to see the same thing, right? So there was a lot of push around personalization, and this is something which is a very tricky part, because whatever said and done, you have only 20 to 30% of the consumer real data available, basis which personalization can really happen. And when you have the kind of that kind of traffic coming onto the platform, it becomes very, very tricky. But within these constraints, what is very important is how do you keep building on that? And that's one thing that there was a huge impetus on that. Other thing that kind of really stood out that you've also kind of touched upon is the omni-channel bit, right? Before that, while there was a focus on omni-channel, but omni-channel kind of became like very important, because we had to create a seamless experience between offline and online. Until then, I would say, while it was there, with this, there was a huge push around omni-channel. And if I could just give you numbers, right? I mean, our overall omni-channel business share to the platform grew at about 10-12%, right? That's massive at that kind of scale. So that, these are some of the things that we experienced, despite being at the digital forefront, these are some, and also right, one more thing that strikes me is this tier three, tier four consumer, right, that came onto the platform. There was a huge growth of tier three, tier four consumers. So for us, it was very important to focus on vernaculum, right? We kind of started going in that direction because the more tier three, tier four you go, the more region specific or geo specific you go, you want to bring in those abilities to be able to communicate, to be able to really enhance your CX. So these are some of the things that kind of started building up for us as well. And we've tried to kind of leverage on some of these things.
Bindya, thanks. Very, very interesting. 450 million.
Yeah.
Sounds like a small number, but I can well imagine the kind of, you know, I think even a 1% shift either which way is monumental. So 10 to 12% movement is well, incredible to say the least. We'll come back on this, Bindya. Ramya, your take in the area that you are in, again, it is similar. Again, offline, online, so that's very interesting. And I think that on Mayank's point of the struggle between, maybe you can spend a little more time on the online, offline. I wanted, in fact, even Bindya to answer that. We'll come back. Is in your environment, in a distributed, the distribution is the offline for Bindya, in a sense that the delivery partners are outside. Right? It's not all core to you if it is, say, a franchise-led model. So you have partners who are outside of you. How do you actually stitch the two of them together? Similarly, if we can, or Ramya, maybe you can just first take, do your take, and I'll come back to Bindya on this. If you can give us your take on how has it been at Swiggy?
First of all, thanks a lot, Ajay. It's amazing to be here. Going back to your question, rather than just talk about Swiggy, because I've just moved into Swiggy like a month ago, I would also want to answer your question.
Yeah, BigBasket also could be a good take, so no problem. Perfect.
Yeah. So I want to answer it from the perspective of BigBasket as well. What we saw, obviously, Bindya covered most of it, but what we saw was a change in the customer adoption of digital itself during the pandemic, right? A lot of people now had access to smartphones and hence internet. We're becoming more and more comfortable using digital as a means to reach out to their brands. And what BigBasket saw was also an explosion of a completely new set of customers whom we have never seen before reaching out to us. So I will split my answer into two sections. One was what we did immediately to address the pandemic explosion in terms of the number of customers trying to order from us and this whole new customer base that has come. And what have we done to sustain that, right? The first part would be that we created way more channels. Like we went completely omni-channel in the non-traditional sense as well. It could be opening up, Google Forms for community ordering, like where an entire apartment complex comes together, creates a Google Form-based order so that one delivery can cater to multiple families, right? Then coming to BB Instant, which was a vending machine placed in offices and co-living spaces, now becoming a 10 machine together store inside apartments where people essentially used it as an unmanned store for their quick needs rather than actually ordering from BigBasket and getting it X days later, right? The other approach we did was to create BB Instant on wheels. Now, if you put the machines in one apartment, it is a store for that apartment. But what if we could put it inside a truck and go from one apartment to another, have set timings in different localities and hence cater to the population across the city, right? That was another interesting thing we did. Now, in addition, there were a lot of people who were not able to access all of these digital means or were not still comfortable. So we created a calling mechanism to our customer service where pregnant ladies, senior citizens, physically challenged customers could just call our customer care center and we would help them place orders and ensure that these are considered priority orders as well. So in addition to this, we created a token system which allowed you to actually take a token and make sure that you get assured deliveries rather than, being in a frantic scenario where you are not even sure whether you'll be able to get your groceries. So these were some of the things we did for immediate term. Now, what we did long term, which we had actually started thinking even before the pandemic, was one, build to scale, right? Create a tech roadmap that is business line agnostic, that allows you to build components which are portable and reusable across business lines. For example, what we built for Big Basket is now usable across BB Instant, BB Daily, our Mandi customers, across 9 different businesses that we are in. And then the move towards a super app approach, wherein can we combine all of our business lines into the same app, and hence provide a seamless way for our customers to access us through all kinds of businesses, like your morning, early morning needs, your monthly groceries, your quick commerce, etc. Then the other interesting thing we did was think about opening physical stores as well, which is where our primary omni-channel comes in, where we opened Fresho stores last month, which essentially is a multilingual supported store, which is for fruits and vegetables with an unmanned checkout and a seamless payment journey. In addition to that, also plays as a buy online pickup in store model for all of the groceries beyond the assortment that's available in the store today. So these were interesting things that BigBasket did. Coming to Swiggy very briefly, what we have done is, of course, moved from stores model where you are picking up from the respective stores that the customer dictated and then getting the SKUs to the customer, actually launch Instamart itself, right? Where it's an inventory-led model, smartly define your micro dark stores to cater to customers within 15 to 20 minutes itself, and open various other business lines like Genie, like Meat, and many more to come. So these have been the changes in the places I've been so far.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Ramya. And I must compliment you on the Instamart itself. My first experience was day before yesterday. And I was, let me call it politely and pleasantly surprised that the delivery happened within that 15-minute time frame, because I stay a little off, I won't say off-grid, but a little off, you know, where it's not the easiest to. And in 8 minutes, the delivery happened. So obviously, what we in technology call near field communication, you all have in Swiggy figured out an offline near field delivery model, which is to me outstanding, because it has stitched together the order booking and closest to exit point from where the customer is to have a delivery done. What was famously a 30-minute pizza delivery by Domino's Pizza. Maybe tomorrow you all will do that with a service guarantee, 50 minutes are free. And we can test that out, but wonderful to hear. Dhanraj, you're a man who does, unlike Bindia, who's 450 million, okay, Indian context, I'm not talking Mercedes-Benz worldwide, but 450,000 per month, yours is low volume, very high value, and hence the, I think the interface with the customer is similar in real estate. The product line, ours is not high volume, it is low volume, but high engagement. Sorry, Bindia and Ramya, I don't mean it is not on the online model, but I meant purely from products like ours, which are for lifetime. You buy a product which lasts you in your case, maybe, you know, Dhanraj, in your case, it may be 10 years, 8 years, 10 years. Here it is a lifetime. That these have a high involvement product. So take us through your journey at Mercedes-Benz on a similar, the digital transformation that you all would have seen, because you all would have faced a lot of challenges, because the product like yours will not be bought online. So how do you marry the two?
Yes, thank you so much, Ajay, for a wonderful question. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. See, if we understand, an average human being spends nearly 4 to 5 hours on the smartphone. Out of that, he or she spends nearly 140 minutes on the social media, on the digital thing. So when it comes to Mercedes-Benz, yes, definitely, it's a lifetime product, what Ajay rightly said. This product is purchased based on the 5 human senses, how you feel, and based on your feeling, the decision is taken by the heart and the mind jointly. So there definitely intervention of human experience is must. But looking to the current change, especially after 2020, Mercedes-Benz has also made a giant leap in terms of 2 customer experiences. First is the buying experience. Second is the user experience. And third is the ownership experience. If I segregate the buying experience, Mercedes-Benz has just come out from 1st of October with you all can Google retail of the future. It is the first manufacturer in India that has introduced retail of the future concept, where customer can directly interact, directly get to know the order made by him, and directly get understand the status of his order also. It is a one nation, one price model, one X showroom price across the India, all showrooms. Customer can see the transparency based on the bookings made by him. That is the first step Mercedes-Benz has taken. Now, when it comes to the user experience, Mercedes has decided to produce the connected cars. That is the first mission. The second mission is to connect the cars which have been produced. So there is a software, and they are making lots of changes in the software by introducing the hardware of Mercedes Me Adapter, where your car can get connected with the network. If your car has some malfunction, it will pop up to your smartphone. There is a Mercedes-Benz application, Mercedes Me Connector and Mercedes Me Adapter, where you can easily understand what kind of service need your car has got. You can get it on your cell phone. You also get a link to book an appointment with the service provider on the phone itself. That is what we call it digital service drive. Right from the service need experience till the payment experience, everything is covered in the digital service drive. You book an appointment through the online link, it goes to the portal. Simultaneously, the car which is connected also gives a message to the service provider that this car has this particular service need. May it be a service demand, or may it be a replacement of brake pads or anything. That message also goes to the service provider. So the loop is closed. The message goes to the service provider also, the message goes to the user also. Then they both get connected. Okay, if you do not want to call, you get a link. On the link, you book the appointment. The appointment is also booked. You can select the slot also. As per the slot, the car user is just sitting at home. The car is picked up from the home. It goes to the workshop. You get each and every update, even where the chauffeur has reached. Because when it comes to the car, it is a 50-70 lakh product which a customer gives to an unknown person. So customer gets a transparency that where the car has gone, from the car reaching to the workshop till it gets serviced, it gets repaired. He gets video calling facility also, and also he gets updated through the WhatsApp also, and definitely phone call is also available and video call is also there. So this all multi-channel communication is utilized for updating the customer for his user experience. Especially most important thing is to reflect the transparency of the transaction made by him. Because an average ticket size in a high-end car of service is not less than 50 to 70,000 rupees. And here customer already has a buying potential, but he wants to understand whether the money spent by him are going in the right direction and right course. So here customer gets all the transparency till the payment link also given to him. That is called the Mercedes-Benz user experience. Now the cars are coming connected cars also. They have also introduced Hey Mercedes. Same can be utilized when you're sitting inside the car. You can ask any question to that device by asking Hey Mercedes, something like Alexa or Siri. So that is how I can say that, yes, the product definitely needs a human experience and human interface, but all the digital experiences have been made in such a way that customer can buy the car by sitting at home, and customer can also get his car serviced or all the service needs facilitated by sitting at home, utilizing all digital channels, multimedia, WhatsApp, message, definitely last but not the least, human experience, a visit by the service representative also is covered. So in terms, both the experiences are available with the customers, human experience as well as digital experience.
Thanks, thanks Abraj. Interesting, and we'll come back, circle around to that question of how the two are married, especially on the servicing side. I think you called it buying, the post-buying, post-purchase experience. That will be the part. Mohit, would love to have your take. It's in the online education space. Give us your insights. My apologies. I know these are nascent in terms of, you know, for us, Swiggy is very, very well known. And it touches at least all of us on this forum. We all have experienced, well, my desire is someday Dhanraj may get us a good discount for a Mercedes Benz. But we've all seen it on the road. We've done a Swiggy. We've done Big Basket. You know, somebody in the family has shopped on Myntra. Education, yes, from our perspective, may not be something that in today's context we're directly in connect with, unless we are doing, you know, a course through EDX or any one of them. So your take on how, what is the relevance in your context, and your audience is similar to probably a Swiggy or a Myntra, a similar audience. Is there a need for you all to have a multi or an omni-channel experience? If so, give us a context, especially in the education, online education space.
Yeah, so thanks, Ajay. And of course, very interesting views from everybody. I think over the, not just the last 2 years, of course, that has kind of propagated a lot of views of all online platforms. I mean, Big Basket was really a blessing during the lockdown period. And so has been kind of, I've worked in the past with Flipkart as well. So of course, Myntra is a very regular shopping destination for everybody in the family. I hope I can be as regular with Dhanraj Mercedes as well. But I think that's important. But I think, see, online education is very interesting, right? Because we all saw that what pandemic can actually do to our kids, where the schools have literally been closed for like literally 1.5 years. And now thankfully they're kind of opening, but again, some kind of challenges which still exist in terms of different variants and all. So we literally saw like a month-on-month 4x growth during the pandemic times, where a lot of kids were looking to obviously cut down their risk of exposure and come on to online and actually learn whether it is their tuitions or preparing for their test, or even on the early learning side, it could be readers, speakers, coders. So all kinds of offerings that we do on an online basis. So we saw a huge kind of uptake in the number of students coming to our platform. And we have a platform which is called as Wave, which is basically our proprietary platform, which we use to take these classes, because platforms like what we generally use for our meetings may not be kind of all good enough for when you're taking mass classes, because you need much better control both from, so we also want to kind of reach the masses. So the internet connectivity across India still remains a bit of a challenge. I mean, broadbands are available in tier 2, tier 3, and they're also getting to villages, but still, there are a lot of kind of issues. So our proprietary platform takes care of that, allows students to kind of come on board and actually study in even like low bandwidth kind of connections. And it's highly interactive. So we have also kind of tried multiple different models from a customer experience or a student experience, what we call point of view, where we have tried like a two teacher model, where there is a teacher who is teaching, but at the same time, you have a class teacher who is also solving doubts, because in part students could have their doubts on specific topics and things like that. So I think that's been an innovation that we have tried. Secondly, being one of the largest kind of a K-12 platform, we also run 20 plus YouTube channels, where we have about 65 million students on a monthly basis coming and actually getting a lot of free classes as well. So a lot of our masterclasses get done and a lot of interesting topics get covered in those YouTube channels. So that's again in line with our vision of actually reaching masses. So when you talked about omni-channel, of course, we don't have a physical, but within the online way, the way we kind of do is like different channels. So Wave being one of our proprietary channels, YouTube being another channel that we use. And in fact, one of the key things that we have recently tried is tying up with DTH platforms like Airtel and Tata Sky to reach places where internet is not even there, because people still have TVs and people have DTH connections, satellite that they can run, and at a very nominal kind of a cost.
Very interesting.
They could actually kind of come online and just study over a TV connection, right? So I think that has been some of the very innovative things in line with our vision to kind of give this access to everybody. Then we kind of obviously also we saw a lot of students who unfortunately lost a family member or maybe an earning family member, or a lot of challenges that people kind of went through over the last few months. So we kind of also launched out an initiative where we are tying up with about 12 to 15,000 students who will give full scholarship in terms of coming and attending classes online as part of our kind of social cause as well. So these are different kind of channels that we are using to one, give the experience of online learning and kind of taking care of students at a very mass scale.
Thanks, Mohit. So I'll reverse it now with my second question and continue it with you. And this I'm taking it from my own daughter's experience. Her college also recently opened. So this is a little interesting because out of say 50 students, 10 of them landed up because they were daring enough or whatever that they landed up in college, and the rest of them were online. Now the challenge is not as much for the students per se, those who are online and those offline, because now, you know, there's somebody sitting in class and there are those online. But the challenge for the one who's imparting the education, the teacher, they could sense the huge complication for the teacher, because here you have somebody offline who also has questions, but the guys online will not know. And the guys online may have questions. So for a teacher to have how do I respond in this environment? So actually, it's very interesting. So I'll call it omni-channel for want of a better word, that since there are two channels coexisting at the same time in the same environment, it's very interesting your sense on how does a teacher, because they are the fundamental. I like the concept of a YouTube using distributed environment. I think that's terrific. That how does a teacher now actually tune into being able to manage both? Because that can be very, very stressful. I'm only taking a small batch of 50. I know we have batches that go up to 150, etc. That becomes very complicated. Just your sense, your take on, let's use the word omnichannel for want of a better word, from the teacher's perspective, the one who delivers it.
Yeah, so I think it's interesting because the person who is actually teaching is having a lot of focus on the content that needs to be imparted. Obviously, there is a course that needs to be covered, and it becomes a bit hard, especially when you have a large batch size, as you mentioned, running into, let's say, several hundreds or even several tens to kind of take these things. And that's where I mentioned that we did this innovation on a two-teacher model, where we have like class sections like we have in an offline model, where a group of, let's say, 20, 30 students are in a section, and multiple sections are being taught by, let's say, a master teacher. So while the master teacher is focusing on taking kind of the content coverage and ensuring the topics are being explained, all the doubts that are being asked are actually taken off by a class teacher who is an equal expert, but is not directly teaching in that particular session. So they are actually on the side, they can actually ask their doubts and they can actually get them answered while being on the session. In addition, we also have like a doubts app where people or students can actually post their doubts post class as well. And there we can kind of help them solve the specific problems and things like that. So our two teacher model and a doubts app is something that we have seen work really well and give a good experience in terms of kind of coverage as well as any issues that students have.
Thanks, Mohit. Bindya, to come back to you.
Sorry, Ajay, you're on mute. I can't hear.
Oh, thank you, Bindya. Thank you so much. So my thanks. So my question, Bindya, is in an online model, you did mention that y'all are seeing changes. Well, y'all have looked at personalization, but even a 10-12% movement is tremendous given the volumes that you have. But what are some of the, I'll call it, drivers of user engagement that you find that are critical in an omni-channel or an online digital space for y'all, and the changes that the last 2 years have brought about? I know for a fact that people are a lot more impatient. They don't forgive very easily if there's a wrong delivery. Now, since even the traditional offline models also have come online because they realize that's a great channel to, at low cost, great channel to expand. And I think Mayank touched on that, that small formats are very difficult to sustain. So hence large formats offline work. But in your context, in the digital medium, what are the key drivers for user engagement, especially taking yours is a very, very involved category. I mean, for any person, it's a very involved category. So it'll be very interesting to know your take on the key drivers for engagement.
Sure. So Ajay, let me just kind of touch upon the fact that right, Myntra is selling mostly fashion and personal care, kids, all of these categories, home, etc. Right? Like you said, it's a very high involvement category. So what is very important is how do you kind of bring both these offline and online experiences together? Now, the difference what happens when you're talking about a single D2C brand or when you're talking about an offline brand, right? There is a certain kind of consumer experience that they're able to give to the brand or to the customer, which in an online kind of an environment, which where I could say it's a market place of sorts, to give that kind of consumer experience to individual brands at a customer level is a bit tricky, right? How do you kind of solve for that? And some of the things that we try to do is, for instance, how do we ensure that anything that is getting launched in offline space gets launched in the online space at the same time? How do we ensure that if there is a loyalty program, right, in the offline channel, how are you able to integrate it in the online space? So that from a customer's standpoint, it doesn't matter, right? If I'm shopping from a brand XYZ, right, Guess or whatever, right, I'm able to get the same kind of loyalty points if I shop at Myntra, right? So that kind of integration. How am I able to ensure that if somebody's bought something online, they can actually go back to the store as if they were like that brand's customer who was shopping at Myntra, for instance, and they're able to do these returns, alterations. In apparel, you have a lot of alterations that happen, right? So how are they able to really go back to the store and do all of those things, right? So there is a reverse, a seamless reverse logistics, right, in place. How are you able to really integrate it in an omni, which is like a real omni channel experience, right, that you're able to give at a brand level. Also, one thing that is very interesting in this space is that every brand has a certain line of a launch that happens, right, at a season level, at a monthly level. Now, like I said, in Myntra context, it's a large platform. To be able to give visibility to each of these lines is very, very tricky, right? So how do you, so we've also kind of working on a social commerce or like an on an Myntra Live Studio kind of an experience where actually influencers or real people are going to talk about those. For instance, I would be saying, I mean, the influencers would be talking about this specific line that is launched from Levi's, right? And this line and would actually, and it's a personalized kind of a content where you actually reach out to Levi's customers and you actually are able to talk to them directly and tell them, okay, these are the lines that I've launched, right? So it's a hard one. It's a difficult one because, like I said, it's catering to many, many D2C and combining them into one and packaging it for your consumers. Again, because of very, very high base that you're speaking about and catering to different need states. But within that, we kind of try to optimize and go deep in everything. So, yeah. So I would say
it's very interesting, Bindya. So let's take, I love that. That these are multi-brands and Levi's has a launch plan for a new brand. Yeah. So the advantage for Myntra is Myntra has by category of shopping experience or shopping brand-wise to be able to get all of that product purchasers to come online and they could be the first, I mean, it's like a new movie launch and you call your loyal customers to have a, you know, one day before preview of very interesting. And yes, that's, I think that itself drives basis your pattern. So both for you and for Ramya, maybe you can take a quick jab and then I'll go to Ramya on this. We don't as much today talk about share of wallet. I don't know why that's some of just gone off everybody's radar that we talk share of wallet. Ramya should be talking about Ajay Nambiar very often because I've got a huge share of wallet with Big Basket. I still do. But it's very interesting. So what's your take? I mean, of course, we do have that with customers in my current product line where customers buy across our product line. And we do look at the lifetime value or share of wallet in that context. Just touch upon that maybe for a minute. And what is it still relevant in this context for you? And then Ramya, you can take a jab at.
See, I mean, the way I look at it in e-commerce, there's going to be a very, because the base itself is so high, we can't really put it in one bucket. I would say that you have to actually go at a consumer age level group, because when you look at different age level, the share of wallet is very different. Because when you look at younger age cohort, the share of wallet is much higher vis-a-vis their earning as a percentage vis-a-vis the older cohorts, etc. Right? So from that perspective, I feel e-commerce is still evolving, because we still, our penetration and overall market is very at a very, very nascent stage. As we keep growing, my sense is the share of wallet penetration will expand, purely because that younger cohort base will expand. But having said that, there is still a cap on what that share of wallet will be. So as the markets open up, etc., there is going to be some normalization that will happen, right? Because finally, I have to spend on a dress. I'm going to buy it. Like, I have parked aside, say, X thousands for that. So I'm going to finally decide where I'm going to buy from. So that rationalization, my sense, is obviously going to happen at some point. But so far, we don't see it as a constraint. In fact, in my mind, like I said, it's only going to expand as the cohorts mature at the platform.
Understood. I'm sorry, Bindya, I may take another minute on this. My question was not at an age category level. That's a little broader. Since we did touch upon personalization and trying to go down share of wallet at an individual level, that and this is how basically you're driving purchase. So if I'm a Levi's and I bought a, you know, pair of jeans, I buy it every month. I buy a pair of jeans. So have you all been able to then personalize it to an extent? And this has a direct correlation to your share of wallet. I mean, everything has a business outcome to it, that you do know that there is a purchase pattern for Ajay Namjar. Every month he does buy Levi's as jeans, that you also know now there are X accessories, B something else, and Ajay gets hit with that. I know it's a relatively simple thing, you must be doing it, but for the audience, it's very interesting to know, especially in a category like ladies, their dress or whatever that they buy, that how do you personalize it to increase a personal share of wallet?
So there are a lot of cross-sell widgets that we have at the cart level. So it happens at every level, to be honest. Like, you have, like, from the funnel, which is your list page, to PDP, we kind of insert this, right, through the funnel. Even from, so basically it will be something like this. If you're shopping for something, right, you will be shown similar products. Then you will also be shown cross-sell products that will go live with it. In fact, we're also investing in chatbots, right, which are like styling assistants, where people can actually say that, listen, I want to go to a wedding, show me the entire look, right, from top to bottom, right? So these kind of widgets, these kind of integrations are happening at every funnel in the consumer journey. The intent is, like you said, right, I mean, intent is to expand the basket size as much as possible. And fortunately for us, we have been expanding our basket size as of now. It's only, we've seen only an upward trend there.
Okay. Ramya, you can take a shot at it too, Ramya.
Sure. So I'll pick this up from the grocery perspective. All right. Now, what has happened recently is that people used to like come to grocery players like Big Basket once a month or twice a month, right? And order large baskets. And then whatever they needed, they would go to nearby Kirana or, you know, most of the shopping would happen like that. Now, recently, we have seen significant reliance on digital players. Now, I'm only talking about the urban population. I am completely aware, and I think tier 3, tier 4, and there is also a huge cohort of customers in urban cities also, which are heavily underpenetrated, which is essentially what Big Basket is trying to do with the fresher stores, etc. Right. So what has happened is there are so many new means of accessing your customer. For instance, quick commerce really didn't exist until very, very recently, right? Nobody thought that people would need stuff within 15 minutes. But the amazing use cases we tackle at Swiggy are, for example, you're cooking, let's say, palak paneer in the morning, and because it's a new recipe you're trying, two of the ingredients are not there. You order something on Swiggy, by the time you have got to that step of the, you know, instruction in the recipe book, you have actually got the ingredients that are missing and you're able to fulfill. Or it's like you're watching a match and you need some munchies, here you go. So there are various use cases that we're able to tackle. So the newer means of that has opened up in the digital space, right? With multilingual apps coming in, more and more people are now adopting social ways of buying. Social commerce, buying on Instagram and Facebook did not exist, right? Now it has started. all the D2C brands like the Whole Truth and all are extremely successful today. So I think what has really happened is the pie itself has become larger. When you're talking about wallet share, right? The earlier, let's say the wallet was this size, the pie itself is larger now because there are various ways of getting to your customer. So what does a retailer do? At least specifically from Instamart's perspective, how do we improve the assortment so that I cater to most of your needs, right? How do I provide you with better substitution? How do I improve your discovery itself of the products that I have, right? Be it through beautiful copies, amazing design, human intelligence in the way we think about product. So that has actually helped significantly in category level penetration. So the result of this is that your average order value goes up and the order becomes more profitable as a result. And the customer thinks of you more frequently than they used to, right? So from a Big Basket's perspective, what they've done is beautifully built a number of businesses wherein every use case you have, you think of Big Basket. For example, your monthly groceries, of course, you order from the Big Basket app. You need something tomorrow morning, let's say you have puja, you need flowers, just go to BB Daily and order along with your milk and, you know, quick vegetables. If you need something now, there is BB Instant. If you have to go to a store, there is Fresho. And soon, I'm sure they'll also get into commerce. So I think it is about tackling the larger pie, creating all use cases and their ability to access you as their single brand that they go to. That has been my experience so far.
So just on that, Ramya, follow-up question on that. So have all these been able, have you all been able to stitch all these together? Typically omni-channel, if you can call it that. So my Fresho experience, if I've gone because I was passing by a Fresho store and I've picked it up, or I wanted something instant, whatever I picked up, are these all directly interlinked? Because I do know with Amazon, I did struggle too because there were two delinked experiences that I had. If I had to go in, you know, when they launched grocery, it was not directly linked to my Prime account and I had to treat that as a separate experience. Earlier, I'm not talking of it today in context, but I'm saying, so all these, you'll have been able to seamlessly link them all together, irrespective of the customer's mode of buying it, from whether it's instant, you know, you've got, I'll call it multiple product lines, servicing the customer basis his need. One is instant, one is he wants it offline, wherever he is, and the other is sitting at home and it gets delivered to him. So all these have been stitched together seamlessly. There's been no challenge in that.
So at Big Basket, at least the identity of the customer has been stitched in. So I'm aware that it is the same Ajay buying on Big Basket versus the Fresho store and across all brands. But to get to a truly omni-channel experience, for example, right, an integrated experience, let's say you are looking for milk or you're looking for any paneer on Big Basket app and we are out of stock for the most bought item that you have. Can I immediately link you to say, hey, get it at 7 a.m. in the morning via BB Daily or go downstairs, your apartment, BB Instant Machine, yeah. As right. Yeah. We have not reached there, but I think that's the goal. Like, and that's essentially why the whole, the BB 2.0 initiative, which Rakshitar, VP of Engineering, spoke about at length, is all about how can I create integrated experiences. And so this is not really a front-end kind of an initiative. It's how can I build a robust backend?
Yeah.
Which will power all of these experiences in the future, right? So that is one. At Swiggy, it is much more simpler because it's the same app. So still, we are getting there. More and more conversations are now happening on how can you have an integrated order system? How can you have an integrated experience across food, Instamart, and various other business lines? But we are not there yet.
Yeah. Appreciate it. No, it's at least there is, it's nice for the audience to also know that while we all are talking on topics or areas that we are subject matter experts or we are representing a brand or a company, that we are not at 100% that we've achieved everything in life. And I think that's the great part of our conversation, that, hey, there is still way to go. We just didn't, you know, get up in the morning and have a eureka moment and suddenly everything just happened. That these are real life struggles, which I think the audience understands and empathizes with, because it is a real life struggle all of us go through. So it's brilliant to know we are not perfect. It's wonderful, because then there is that headway for all of us to say, hey, you know, when we talk the next time, we've probably made as Bindya said, that 10 to 12% improvement is huge, that we made that improvement and we still have, who knows, tomorrow there could be something else and we've got a gap of another 10, 15% to go. So I think that gives everybody hope that we've not reached the Holy Grail yet and that Holy Grail is a moving target. Dhanraj, on you, I think very, very important. It's a stable brand. It's been stable for a long time. It's a known brand. How do you ensure through effective user engagement, you also will have churn? I mean, the nature of your business also is it's so highly competitive. It has now come down to a price point fight between brands because if you ask me, typical German brands all give at a class level. I'm not talking at, you know, a Maybach versus a regular Mercedes-Benz. That how do you ensure attrition, if I can use the word attrition or a loss, a customer loss or a customer churn, that you all are able to keep the customer engaged and bring him back in the fold? And this I talk from an experience of my own friends who've switched between brands. You know, 3 years they're on an Audi and they move to a Mercedes and then, you know, they're onto a BMW amongst the three of y'all, known brands. How do you ensure that you have kept the customer engaged, that he stays back with you, or early signs are detected that you know this customer has either product fatigue or that he's looking at switching and you're able to bring him back?
Yeah, this is a wonderful question for which right now the German automotive brands are facing. I would call it that challenge is retention, retaining the customers with the brand. Actually, as what you asked, I think I'll put it in the same frame. Okay, how do we ensure that we retain the customers with us? Well, I must say that retaining an old customer generally takes 10 to 15% of marketing budget, but contributes to at least 30 to 35% of business revenue. Because that customer already has a buying potential with it. Because of some reason, he might have either experimented to go with other brand or he might have, you know, decided that he wants to go with this brand. So in order to retain these customers with the brand, if we talk about Mercedes-Benz, the Mercedes-Benz has come up with a wonderful ownership packages. Yeah. Also the agility packages. So you are given option, you are always given an option from the buying the car till your car is 3 to 4 year old. If you're buying a car, you get an option of getting an agility. You get a third year or fourth year assured buyback price from the dealer. So in that case, that is one attempt made to retain the customer with us. A salesperson will ask, sir, after 3 years or 40, 50,000 kilometer, how much price do you expect? See, if the car is a 55, 60 lakh rupees, customer would say, I would expect 25 lakh. Sir, what if I give you 30 lakh after usage of 3 years and only 40,000 kilometers? So customer will definitely say, wow, I'd like to go for that option. So that is, we call it as an agility plan given by Mercedes-Benz. So that option is given to customer when buying the product. When he completes the purchase of the product, he also gets an opportunity to get, there is a 3 years warranty also, and the service is also there. He is also given two options, additional warranty, fourth and fifth year, also the service packages, annual maintenance packages. And as per the Blue Book survey, Mercedes-Benz service packages contribute one of the lowest ownership cost among all the luxury brands. We also market it is less than price of an Uber also. So if we buy, because everybody thinks that service cost is very high, service ka price bahut jyada hai. So service cost is capped over there. It is given from 3 years till 10 years of ownership package. Right? And what customer gets the benefit? He gets the benefit of price hike every year. Every year, 3 to 5% price hike is there only for oil. He gets that price hike. He doesn't have to pay anything. So that option he gets at the time of purchase of the car. Now around 2 or 3 years has happened. His life cycle, product life cycle is about to be over. And that's the third year or fourth year. Then when he thinks of, you know, the cost is, even that time also he has given a separate package of annual maintenance package, specially designed, or the warranty, specially designed for the cars older than 3 years also.
Okay.
So these are all the options given to customers to retain them with the brand. And all these options are digitally available.
Appreciate.
He can just select, he can change in his chassis number or his registration number on the Mercedes-Benz website. He can understand whatever offers have been designed exclusively for his car. May it be the tire price, may it be the brake pad price. If you enter your registration number of the car, you will get to know what customized offers are available with the dealer for exclusively designed for your car. Okay. So these are the various kind of efforts made. Definitely human interface is also there and digital is also there.
Great. Thanks. Appreciate it. I think thanks to all four of you all. I think this has been exceptionally engaging to get your points of view from your perspectives, not just your organization, but also your personal perspectives. I'm throwing this open to the audience, and we already have one question that has come in. Any of you all can choose to nominate yourself to answer it. And this is, I think this always comes up, that there's always a fight in personalization and privacy. There's always a fight. I mean, our GDPR, India's own policy on privacy has not yet been passed by Parliament. It is still an act yet to be enforced. It will come at some point. There are discussion, debates, papers have been put out on that. But what's your take? I think the question is, how do you bring together personalization and privacy? I would like to say, how do you maintain, to what extent of privacy? Where is the boundary line that you draw between personalization and privacy? Very, very interesting question. Anybody can take a shot at it.
I think Jay, I can probably throw some
light.
I think it's this is a pretty interesting topic, right? So it is important, specifically, let's say if we talk about Vedantu.
And we can do a whole session on just this.
Yeah, I think it's important to kind of take privacy, securities, and specifically for us, like a child security is extremely important, right? Because we are dealing with kids and all of that. So we kind of take obviously all the care to ensure that the data which is being shared. So obviously the teachers have access to records like maybe what's the test scores, what is the kind of engagement levels and things like that. That is kept restricted and controlled in terms of who is having access to the data. And at the same time, the report cards that go out from a technology point of view are highly personalized in terms of what are your learning objectives, where do you stand in terms of those learning objectives as of date, and how you're progressing towards it. But at the same time, I think we ensure that it is not being accessible to kind of everybody. So obviously we are trying to put a lot of checks and balances. So like even the chats, right? So for example, we are having this session today. And when you kind of do this kind of a session with students in, let's say, number of tens and hundreds, then ensuring you're actually moderating the chats, that information is not being accessible to everybody, personal information like phone numbers not being shared on that. So a lot of those checks and balances need to be built in, and a lot of technology controls can also help with that. But it goes hand in hand. I mean, it can't just be a one size fits
all.
So I think every industry, every particular use case has to be dealt a bit differently. And the right checks, which kind of merit that particular use case, needs to be implemented.
I agree, Mohit. I quite agree. And I must give a context in the industry that I'm currently in, real estate. And a simple example, you know, you go buy a house, you buy an apartment, and when the apartment comes for a handover, we get suddenly our customers getting very upset that they find a spurt of brokers calling them, getting in touch with them that, I believe your property has been handed over. Would you like to sell? Would you like to rent? And they always come back and point back at the developer, stating that you are the guys who have given out the data. Now, A, of course, you have privacy. We have privacy laws. We have data protected. But a simple question is, whenever they want to see their property, they go to the main gate, and there the security guard has a register in which he says, give me your phone number, right? And the minute you write your phone number at 5,000 rupees a pop, any channel partner can give it to him and take the entire database without having to blink. These are challenges. And of course, you know, we keep educating them on that, but we are trying to move away onto, you know, app-based model where data does not get stored on a simple register. But yours is interesting. For example, since it is student sensitive, it is, you know, students, video, I think forget any other technology, but video is both a huge boon and also a bane in terms of video recording and privacy and anything which has to do in that space. So I'm sure that's where, you know, everything is permission based, and if permission based is stored and secure from that student and his or her parents' point of view. So very interesting. Anybody else? Bindiya, Ramya, Dhanraj, would like to
start? I'd like to just add one thing here. For our industry, personalization is the most important thing, because if we don't have that consumer data, we'll not be essentially able to even build on the consumer experience, which may be true or untrue for most of the other industry. It's important. But for us, it is just the key pillar for building. For instance, what I'm trying to say is that if I have the right consumer data, I will be able to, in fact, go and tell the consumer, basis your body type, you may want to select this. Basis your last shopping, you may want to go for this size, things like that, which is actually very, very important for the consumer experience standpoint, the way that I want to really build my experience from now to how it should be ideally, right? So, and like you said, like Mohit touched upon, it is obviously extremely important for organizations to create that balance between the data privacy and the personalization. And like I said in the beginning as well, we've not really reached the personalization. And for instance, just to give you a number, right? I mean, today we have only 30% of the consumer data, 30% of the overall consumer data that is available with us, which is very, very small. And because of which we have limited personalization levers also at the platform, because 70% we don't have any idea on the closer data inputs, right? So it is very, very tricky. There is always that balance required. And as an organization, we're always trying to optimize. But having said that, this is very important for e-commerce firms to keep optimizing and keep building on that experience. So we have to keep figuring the balance.
I think it's also a bit on the consumer side as well, Ajay. I would say, if we get a call from our banks and somebody addresses you like, hi, Ajay, or hi, Bindiya, I think that's a much better experience rather than somebody saying, hi, Mr. X, and I don't know anything about you, right? I mean, I think that kind of a personalization flavor, even from a consumer point of view, it's important, but with right control. So obviously, consumers should be able to decide as to what they would want to share, what they would not want to share. But overarching, either this side or totally that side may not work in any of the industries.
Yeah, there is no perfect answer to that. I think it is an evolving process both ways. And it's interesting, I remember when we were filling up an application form and there were some 60 questions because the marketing guys want everything possible. And as Bindiya said, she only has 30% information. At a fundamental level, we filled up, we asked for 60 questions and we got only two answered in a sense in an application form, because nobody wants to fill it up multiple times. I mean, ideally if you can link it through a KYC or through anything else that you can link and get information is great. So we split that over a 2-year period into collecting a very base level information, adding maybe 2 more, 3 more information pieces 3 months down the line, gamifying it or incentivizing it, and then adding 3 more. Marketing guys are very impatient. They want all up front, right? So that was one. We found the most interesting part, date of birth. As collected on the form had a, MMDDYY, as collected on a physical form of DDMMYY. So not just privacy and personalization. I think the base, I remember doing a seminar on big data. The base for anything is in data collection is garbage in, garbage out. So more than privacy and personalization is the core focus on getting right information upfront. So as Bindiya said, they have 30%. If it was 30% of say 10 data points of a customer, Bindiya would be more than happy to have 100% of 3 data points, because that gives her a base level, and then build 4 more later. So there is that challenge also, that how much of data, when do you collect? That you get the right information, and you can actually take informed decisions basis that. So very, very interesting. Thanks again. We are running short of time. My apologies. It's been very, very engaging. I've thoroughly enjoyed moderating this session with the 4 of y'all. Thank you so much.